with your hosts, Drs. Saeed Azeri, Lindsay James, and Ara Salabian. This is the PRS Journal Club podcast.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the September 2021 edition of the PRS Journal Club podcast. My name is Ara Salabian. I'm one of the resident ambassadors and a microsurgery fellow at the University of Southern California. And I'm joined, as always, by my co-ambassadors, Saeed Azeri, who is a microsurgery fellow at Memorial Sloan Kettering, and Lindsay James, who's a chief resident from Northwestern University. Of note, this year we're celebrating 75 years of plastic and reconstructive surgery. This is a year-long celebration that includes many special editorials, monthly CME double features, and much more to look out for. So today we have the honor of being joined by Dr. Mitchell Pett for our discussion. Dr. Pett is an assistant professor in Division of Plastic and Reconstructive Surgery and Associate Program Director for the Hand and Microsurgery Fellowship at Washington University in St. Louis. So thank you so much, Dr. Pett, for joining us for this PRS Journal Club podcast.
Oh, thank you for having me.
So the article we'll be discussing for this session is entitled Short and Long-Term Outcomes Following Severe Traumatic Lower Extremity Reconstruction, The Value of an Orthoplastic Limb Salvage Center to Racially Underserved Communities. And this was from senior authors, Drs. Levin, Butler, and Kovac from the Division of Plastic Surgery and Department of Orthopedic Surgery at the University of Pennsylvania. As a quick reminder, this article, along with all the other articles that are discussed in the podcast, can be read for free on prsjournal.com, including an archive of all the past Journal Club articles. So briefly, as an introduction, racial and socioeconomic disparities have been well reported in outcomes after lower extremity reconstruction, among other things, and studies have demonstrated greater disability, importantly, as well as greater amputation rates in African-American and Hispanic patients after traumatic lower extremity injury. Relatively recent advances, including a more multidisciplinary approach to lower extremity trauma by both orthopedic and plastic surgeons, which is often termed an orthoplastic approach, has helped improve outcomes and decrease complications in lower extremity reconstruction. And the authors have shown this in prior studies. And the authors, again, in this study, attempted to go a step further and sought to determine whether an orthoplastic approach to lower extremity reconstruction could help reduce some of these racial disparities that have been reported in both short and long-term outcomes after lower extremity reconstruction. So they performed a retrospective review of all patients requiring free flap reconstruction of below knee lower extremity traumatic injuries, and this was over a long period at 2002 to 2019. They looked at several demographic factors, which included self-identified race, employment status, as well as U.S. Census characteristics stratified by the zip code for each patient, and then multiple other variables from the medical records, comorbidities, the severity of injury, time to coverage, and their outcomes included flap failure, reoperation, readmission, weight bearing, and ambulation status, and chronic pain management, the need for chronic pain management. They also propensity score matched based on significant demographic differences to standardize their analysis and isolate it by race. So overall, a total of 173 patients were included, of which 61% were Caucasian, 29% African-American, and around 10% identified as other. Comorbidities were similar across these three groups. However, African-American patients were found to have significantly lower rates of private insurance, as well as a significantly lower median household income based on the census data they collected. After matching, there were 13 patients in each cohort. Importantly, there were no preoperative differences among the racial cohorts, as well as no differences in flap failure rates, no differences in reoperation, the incidence of osteo readmission, as well as overall amputation. And long-term outcomes, including ambulation status, their best weight-bearing status, their ability to return to work, which was around 82%, and the need for chronic pain management were, again, similar across all these groups. So I really enjoyed this paper because I think it tackled an important and difficult problem that's not only an issue in lower extremity reconstruction, but endemic to reconstructive surgery, as well as many other areas. And the authors were able to show another yet potential benefit of a really important thing, which I think is multidisciplinary, in this case, orthoplastic approach to lower extremity reconstruction, here showing the ability to potentially mitigate the effects of race and socioeconomic status when compared to historical controls in the literature. I do think it's important to note that this is coming out of a very well-known, high-volume, tertiary, highly experienced center in treating these patients. I do like that they also looked at, in addition to things such as just flap loss, infection rates, they looked at ambulation, return to work, the need for pain management, which I think is critical. I know it's tough in a retrospective review, but it might have been nice to have some other racial categories as well. And then on a side note too, I thought their dangling protocol was interesting. I think they mentioned that they start around 2 weeks, and then we can chat about that. We usually start a little bit earlier depending on how things go, but that's just a side note. But overall, I did enjoy the paper, and I think it has a lot of good points and brings up a lot of good topics for discussion about some of these issues. So with that, Dr. Pett, I'd love just to get some of your main thoughts about this paper, takeaways about their conclusions and their experiences in this topic.
Thank you so much. I think you brought up a lot of the really important points from this paper. I think it's a really important contribution looking at the outcomes of lower extremity salvage from the group that really knows a lot about this topic. So it's worth, you know, listening to what they have to say. You know, they looked at a lot of demographic factors which are thought to contribute to negative outcomes, including race and things that are associated with race. I think that their evidence, they offer some compelling evidence that other centers have found stark differences with performing reconstructive surgery in, you know, relatively disadvantaged populations. Center seems to have, at least in the way they looked at it, kind of evened out some of the outcomes across racial lines when other things are controlled for. And, you know, before we go in and look at, you know, whether they've done that or whether more can be done or how they've done it, I think it's important to say that the fact that these papers are getting written and this is getting looked at, I think is a good thing. It's not as good as fixing the problem and having a perfect solution, but certainly getting it into our mainstream literature and acknowledging, you know, some of the areas in which we all, you know, may routinely underdeliver is really important. And so that's to be committed. You know, they concluded that their orthoplastic team setup is a major contributor to this favorable spread of outcomes. And they had concluded and advocated that a patient should be referred to these type of centers that can offer this type of service. You know, fundamentally, I agree with what they concluded, which is their overarching thesis statement is that multidisciplinary reconstructive care is better for all patients with these type of really complex issues rather than sort of piecemeal care. And probably this is disproportionately advantageous for patients who are, you know, living on the margins or have characteristics that may make them at risk for negative outcomes. And they listed many of those. The thing that I thought was the most interesting in this paper was their final figure, which I think brings up some of the most interesting points in this whole arena, which is they talked about the composition of their multidisciplinary team. In the title of this article, they talk about orthoplastics. And I'm part of a really awesome orthoplastic team. And of course, we're always, you know, jockeying for who takes credit for good outcomes and or bad outcomes. And we're all in this together, of course. But, you know, really, I think that orthoplastics here is an understatement for what's the type of team that they have working. And especially when they're looking at racial disparities, I think that so much of the problems that we see that lead to negative outcomes happen after discharge or during follow-up or prior to injury. And so to call it orthoplastics and to sort of, and of course, I realize that they're sharing credit everywhere, but, you know, to speak about it as orthoplastics, you know, we need to recognize that a lot of this really goes to social work and nutrition and nursing and finance and infectious disease and pain management. And what I wanted from the end of this paper, I wanted to know, and what I'd love to read in the future, is how are they doing their access improvement and how are they doing post-discharge care? How are they dealing with patients that aren't able to get IV antibiotics as an outpatient or patients who can't get back to the clinic or patients who can't get crutches or a knee scooter? Because I would bet that they have got some really good workarounds and a big part of their team devoted to those efforts. And while I really enjoyed reading what they put together, I would have loved to know how have they structured that end after ortho and after plastics?
Yeah, thank you. Those are some excellent points. That figure really is, I mean, for the listeners and the readers who are going through this paper is huge, I think, and it really helps break things down. And again, like you said, I can't really break it down to percentages, but a lot of this comes at that follow-up box, which is the last box, how you get patients back in, how you follow patients, especially when, you know, just as you said, you're dealing with patients that are going to have trouble coming in, are going to have trouble getting to clinic, getting off work, going back to work, things like that. So I think the even more than orthoplastic, as you're hinting at, the multidisciplinary approach, you know, really stands out here. You know, they mentioned in the intro several studies, you know, which are all out there, that similarly report on unfortunately, but truly on some of these racial disparities in other subspecialties, whether it's hand, craniofacial. Have you anecdotally witnessed any similar disparities in your practice?
Oh, certainly. I mean, we had a wonderful guest speaker come to talk about this to our group recently. And, you know, one of her main thesis statements to our group was that if you look for racial disparities, you'll find them, and that they're pretty much anywhere in our healthcare system. And I don't think she was trying to discourage studies that identify them, but try to put in perspective that, you know, finding these type of things is no longer news, but rather it's a call to action to try to do something about it. And I think that this paper, you know, recognizes that, and they're talking about the things they're trying to do and the ways to improve disparities. So that's a good thing. But certainly in my practice, you know, places that I notice at night, I do a lot of lower extremity reconstruction. I certainly see it there. And I think I've already tipped my hand of what I think are the major contributors in my practice, which is I like to think we do the anastomosis that pretty much the same way every time. I think that the same plates go in on the same types of bones, but that when it gets to getting patients dispositioned to care facilities or IV antibiotics as an outpatient rather than, you know, your second choice oral regimen or the durable medical equipment that's necessary to help with rehab or transportation to rehab is where we see it there. And that's kind of what I was touching on for what I'd love to hear about what the Penn group is doing better. But certainly in the, you know, the other side of my practice, you know, in my hand surgical practice, one area that we're actually studying some of these similar issues is in flexor tendon repair. You know, something that we do all the time and looking at the interaction between therapy attendance and socioeconomic variables and flexor tendon outcomes, because we've certainly seen that in disadvantaged populations, they get inferior flexor tendon outcomes. And we'd like to understand what we can do to try and mitigate that, because as you can imagine, that really, in a hand surgeon's practice, it's a very glaring issue.
Definitely. I think it's a great kind of example, again, of the importance, you know, doing the tendon repair, like you said, I think you do things the same way every time, do the best you can, but then the importance of the follow-up, the therapy, the hand therapy, the protocols, and how critical that stuff can be. I think lastly, I mean, you touched upon this, but you know, what I just love to get your thoughts again on how you think, you know, the multidisciplinary approach fits into these areas, whether it's lower extremity reconstruction, upper extremity, that you do a lot of how it can rectify, whether it's racial, socioeconomic, or even just reconstructive outcomes in general, and how you maybe in your practice kind of you've seen the benefits of that, of the team approach, if you want to call
it. I think that it's a question that has to be it's answered on many levels. There's certainly benefit to be gained from, you know, smooth cooperation of clinical teams in the hospital and post-hospital, and examples of, you know, a prompt medical care, you know, that's characterized by good communication to deliver, you know, good surgery and getting the plates covered, you know, shortly after they're put in or same day or in efficient manner is good. I think as you move to the outpatient setting, there are things that clinicians can do, like coordinating their follow-up care or maybe delegating follow-up care to one provider for a specific phase of the follow-up can be helpful to decrease the burden of travel. But beyond that, there's not a whole ton that falls in the clinical purview, and it speaks to how important it is that we work with other disciplines like social work and finance and administration and things like that to break down barriers that are real. I mean, we can talk all we want about addressing disparities, but if nobody's going to pay for the IV antibiotics, or if they're not accessible and will not be dispensed to a given patient, then that's a disadvantage. And so what that speaks to is if, you know, we want to take this further, there has to be, you know, change of the fabric of our support system, whether that's at the hospital or, you know, state or national level.
Definitely. Thank you. Those are really important points. And I think, unfortunately, not talked about all the time or published on, but hopefully, you know, I think papers like this kind of can bring some of that stuff to the forefront and help move it forward. I think with that, you know, I'll turn it over to the resident ambassadors. Maybe, Saeed, starting with you, not to put you on the spot, we can always edit it out, but you know, you went to Penn for 6 years. How did you kind of see, maybe just focusing on that follow-up period, if you ever got to see some of these patients in clinic that were managed in this multidisciplinary approach come back, and how was that kind of coordinated? Do you see the benefits of that yourself while you were there?
Yeah, thanks, Ryan. Thanks, Dr. Pat. One thing just quickly I wanted to mention that, you know, again, I'm reminded of after talking about this article is how the term orthoplastic approach can, you know, historically, even, you know, when people credit Marco Gadina and Scott Levin with the term, everyone talks about kind of the concerted teamwork between orthopedic surgery and plastic surgery. But what, as Dr. Pett was mentioning, and what I've certainly appreciated over my 6 years is how it's way more than that. And as we all just mentioned, it's really just the follow-up of social work, infectious disease docs, even the vascular surgeons, rehabilitative specialists, every single person involved. And that's really, in the 6 years that I spent in training, this is just sprouting all around the country. Clearly, everyone's talking about multidisciplinary care. It's nothing new. It's certainly nothing that Penn started. But Scott, Dr. Levin definitely has created many, many different, almost like sub-teams that are involved in not only the, you know, right at the time of admission, tracking these patients throughout the hospital, maybe like coordinating the team rounds on these patients between the various specialty services, as we've talked about on prior podcasts. And then, as we all just mentioned, the social support and the follow-up afterwards that is involved. But he has, you know, this is almost a whole discussion that I don't want to devote to this whole podcast, but he's kind of created almost like an empire of teams that are involved in the care of each one of these patients. But this whole topic, you know, it's nothing new. Even people talked about going back to the 2002 LEAP study and the importance of social support. And obviously, you know, credit to those authors kind of bringing to light the importance of follow-up in these patients and how much the social support is important for patients with lower extremity trauma, and same could be said for upper extremity trauma. But it's been really nice and encouraging to see what's happening around the country, all the credits that's going on to the multidisciplinary teams, and really just see it evolve over a six-year period.
Thanks, Saeed. Yeah, that's super helpful. And I think, again, kind of highlights what we talked about, and it really brings to the forefront some of these things that you don't really hear about or read about, for whatever reason that is, but that are so critical in managing these what can be very, very difficult patients. Hopefully, and as you said, it's great that it's really coming to the forefront, and we'll keep seeing more of this. And with that can only come, as we said, hopefully better outcomes. And Lindsay, I guess kind of the same thing. In Chicago, have you seen similar, we can just stick with lower extremity, and disparities, as have been mentioned in some of the articles in this paper, and what's kind of the approach there to managing these patients?
Yeah, Ara, thanks so much. It's been a great discussion so far. I think as Dr. Pett mentioned, you know, if you look for racial disparities, you will find them. And I think that's universal. So, you know, I think it's something that at Northwestern, there's a concerted effort too. And I think, you know, as we've talked about in this conversation, a lot of this approach of multidisciplinary or sort of having a system in place to sort of care for these patients really, I think, is the best approach, because the less you're depending on independent providers to make referrals, I think, whether that's to social work or to, you know, the orthopedic surgeon asking the plastic surgeon to get involved, the more you just kind of all generally see these patients as a team, I think the less bias you're minimizing every time. And so I think that while we don't have probably as great of a systems approach as they do at Penn in terms of multidisciplinary follow-up and systems approaches and protocols in place, I think it's something that is definitely worth implementing. And I think something that, you know, we're starting to work on at Northwestern.
Awesome. Awesome. Great. Thanks very much. I think with that, that was a great discussion. We'll end and move on to the next article. Remember to tune in to the other two articles we'll be discussing on this month's podcast, as well as the PRS Journal Club podcast that we broadcast every month. Also, please do not forget to participate in our monthly PRS Journal Club on Facebook, where we will be able to interact directly with this month's selected articles authors. And finally, thank you again, Dr. Pett, very much for joining us for this PRS Journal Club podcast.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for listening to the award-winning PRS Journal Club podcast. Please subscribe and leave a rating or review if you are enjoying what we do and love.